Sights and Sounds of Historic Berks on BCTV is supported by the Berks Heritage Council.
Good evening and welcome to Sights and Sounds of Historic Berks County. I'm your host, Amanda Machik, and tonight I'm joined by Brad Kissam, President of the Historic Preservation Trust of Berks County and President of the Daniel Boone Homestead Associates. Thanks for joining me tonight, Brad.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me.
So I think we're going to go ahead and get started right away with the Daniel Boone Homestead. Brad, if you just want to start us off with just a real brief background, but then I know we have some photos here to share with some of the historic buildings.
Just a quick synopsis of how the Daniel Boone Homestead has evolved over the years, not going all the way back to the Boone period, but the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania became involved with the homestead and what is now known as the Daniel Boone Homestead in the 1930s. So we're approaching the 100th anniversary of this. And the property has evolved. The amount of land has increased significantly from that first those days in the 1930s. There's been restoration work done on the house, which is still evolving, and the slides that are up on the screen right now are a testament to that. I think most people in Berks County remember the main structure, the Boone house, for lack of a better term, as having white trim, and it was that way for decades. And through paint analysis that has been done over a number of years, it was discovered that rather than the lead white paint, it was actually Spanish brown. And we're extremely pleased with the results. This is one of the projects that the Commonwealth took on in the last few years, was to repaint the house, the trim. They also removed all the window sashes, refurbished all of those. So the house got a real makeover. It also got a new roof, a new wooden shake roof about 2 to 3 years ago. So that's one of the projects that is ongoing. Most people are aware that the homestead had been closed for an extended period of time. Part of which was due to the COVID situation. We reorganized the support group at the Daniel Boone Homestead. It is now known as the Daniel Boone Homestead Associates. And through the effort of those volunteers and our site administrator, Heather Hicks, we have made huge progress in the last year and a half. And I just want to say thank you to the board of the associates. Jim Lewers, who is the vice president, Amanda, who is our secretary. We have Beverly Connors, who is the treasurer. And then we have the board is the rest of the board is made up of Diane Kruger, Van Potiger, Brent Erb, Larry Drogo, Kelly Klein, and Sue Spiros. And everybody has just done an amazing job over the last year and a half to get the site back up and running. And it's been quite successful. And we're looking forward to a really great year starting in next year in 2022. Unfortunately, the site will be closed for the next 2 months, which is not uncommon with quite a few historic sites in this day and age, especially with the COVID situation. A lot of sites are taking a two-month hiatus, so we will be reopening on the 13th of March, and that will be the statewide recognition or celebration of the Penn Charter, that's Charter Day. So mark your calendars. We will be reopening on the 13th of March. So just to touch on some of the other projects that have been accomplished, I mentioned the major work that has been done on the main structure. big plus, which most people will never be aware of, is that the site is now connected to public sewer, which for decades we had an on-site septic treatment plant, and the state made the decision to connect to public sewer. So that was a huge project, which has now been completed. We have a whole new lighting package that is going to change the appearance of the homestead. There will be lighting at the main entrance. The wall, which has the Danubian Homestead logo or sign on it, will be illuminated at night. The flags will be illuminated in the evenings, and we are getting new lighting for the visitor center parking lot. The visitor center itself is getting a big makeover, huge makeover. All new lighting in the building. We're getting new exhibits, which will be in place and ready for visitors when we open in March. Hopefully, we're told we will be getting central air in that building. We have a new information desk in the visitor center, and the restrooms in the visitor center are now all ADA compliant. So the state has done an amazing job with the visitor center. It's going to be there to welcome visitors when we reopen. And we're also working in conjunction with Exeter Township. We have been over the last year on what is known as the master plan. Exeter is, contrary to what is even out there in the public, that Exeter will be taking over the homestead. PHMC is not relinquishing the ownership or the management or the day-to-day operation of the homestead, but we're going to work in partnership with Exeter Township, and they help to fund a master plan, which is, and they brought in experts in many fields to analyze the homestead, partly for the historic core area, but to look at the greater use of the park, which is the largest non-recreational park in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. We have 579 acres at Boone, and we at one time there was an extensive trail system. We'd like to bring that back and encourage the public to come down and use the trails. We're going to be expanding the nature areas. The lake is going to get a complete dredging and refurbishing. They're going to work on the trails around the lake. They're going to be working on the dam breast at the lake. So there's just a lot of projects finished, in process, and on the planning table right now. As you're going through these slides on the screen, obviously you saw the Boone House originally. Then there were some photos of the bank barn.
Now that recently got a fresh coat of paint, right? The barn?
It did. And they also
And the blacksmith shop?
I beg your pardon?
Did the blacksmith shop get...
Not this time. No, the blacksmith shop that was done a few years ago. That was a complete makeover with that. They took out, they removed all the chinking from between the logs. They put a drainage system around the back of the blacksmith shop to divert water away from it, so it would slow or eliminate a lot of the deterioration of the building. So that was done a few years ago. The other slide on the screen right now is another building on the site. That is the Bertolette Log House, which was moved to the site from the Ole Valley, as was the blacksmith shop, was moved to the site. This is probably one of the best examples of a Germanic log structure in existence today, and at least in southeastern Pennsylvania. typical Germanic floor plan, three rooms on the main level, the kitchen, the stove room, and the bedroom on the first floor, and a loft above. If you notice in the slide on the right, you may not be able to quite see, but there's a kick to the roof at on the eaves. That's again a carryover from the Germanic tradition to get the snow load away from the building as much as possible. It's a great structure, it really is. The other building that we have, or the other structure that we have on the property, would be the sawmill, which also was moved from the Ole Valley and is one of only two or three functioning water-driven vertical blade sawmills left in the entire country. So we're very, very privileged and very honored to have that. And speaking about the sawmill, going back to dredging the lake, that will ensure that we have enough water power to run the sawmill for years to come. And the other slide is the Wayside Lodge, which is not a colonial structure, although it appears to be, and confuses many visitors to the Boone Homestead. This was actually a works project and is familiar to many scout groups and church groups who have spent many, hopefully very memorable evenings and events there over the years. This is available for rental. And the last slides we have in relation to the Boone Homestead are just some things, slides that represent our Christmas event that we had on December 11th to commemorate a colonial Christmas in the traditional manner. And we tried to represent the lack of celebration that the Quakers would have had, because the Boones were Quakers, and then the Moggridge influence would have been the English Christmas, and the German Christmas representing the traditions that the Dieterk family would have celebrated when they lived and owned the what is now the Danny Boone Homestead. So, did you have any questions, Amanda?
No, that's great. So obviously, there are events going on. I know you had mentioned the 2-month closure, but then we'll be reopening in March with Charter Day, but then other events are also planned or will be planned as well?
Absolutely, yeah. We're looking to expand our event schedule. But even when there aren't events, I want to remind everybody that the site is open. We plan definitely to be open Fridays, Saturdays, and Sundays when we get back up and running. We may expand that if we have the proper manpower, and the visitorship seems to warrant expanding visitation. But the site is open for anybody who wants to come and walk the site. We are open from, you know, basically 9 o'clock in the morning till 5 o'clock in the afternoon. And if you want to come anytime outside of those hours, feel free to park at the main entrance and you can skirt by the gate and walk the grounds. We ask that you probably be out by dark. But beyond that, you're free to come in and experience the homestead. You know, walk around the historic area, but, you know, experience it as a recreational area too.
Very cool. All right. Well, thank you so much. And I know we have the Historic Preservation Trust of Berks County to share a little bit yet, especially the restoration work that's being done on the George Douglas Mansion in Moorlatin Village in Douglasville. So here we have some really great photos showing some of the completed work, both inside and out. So do you want to start us off with a little bit about that? This is a project that's been Gosh, I feel like going on for quite some time.
These projects don't seem to move as quickly, although the ones at Boone really haven't been moving quickly. People have to understand that they requests for a lot of that work have been in place for almost 10 years. It just till they get into the pipeline and get funded. People coming to Moore Latin Village may think that these projects just seem to be progressing at a snail's pace, but it's not that we don't care about our buildings. It's just that unlike the Daniel Boone Homestead, which is a state historic site, the Historic Preservation Trust of Berks County is a 501c3 nonprofit, completely funded by donations and occasional fundraising events. So funding is a huge issue for the Preservation Trust. And on top of that, and we're going to talk about the Douglas Mansion and the Mounds Jones House tonight, we own 18th century structures. We own, obviously, the Mounds Jones House, which is also in Douglasville and Moore Latin Village. That's the oldest existing stone structure in Berks County. That's dated 1716. Also in Douglasville, we have the Michael Fulp House, which is 1783. We have the obviously the Douglas Mansion, which is 1765, and we have the White Horse Tavern, which is 1762. We also own the Hottenstein Mansion outside of Kutztown. That was dated 1783, and the Jacob Keim Homestead in Ole Valley, Loboxville, that's 1753. By the way, the Jacob Keim Homestead is on the National Registry of Historic Sites. So that's quite an honor for us. And then one of the buildings that we don't own, but we maintain, is the Deterk House in Ole. These are slides of the Keim Homestead in Loboxville. That underwent a great deal of exterior restoration a few years ago. That's been kind of put on the back burner for now, and we've been focusing on Moore Latin quite a bit. The structure you see on the screen right, oh, there we go, we're back to the Keim Homestead. A lot of people remember when there was, for lack of a better kind of wraparound porch around the Keim House. That was removed a few years ago. The pent roof was replaced. The second level balcony was reinstalled. The structure that we really need to work on at the Keim Homestead is the ancillary structure, which you see on the right-hand side of that slide. That is a contemporary structure dated also to 1753. That's contemporary with the main section of the Keim House. The section that you see on the far right of the main structure with the white trim, that's a later addition. That's a federal addition. And then the barn in the right slide, that's the one of approximately 20 buildings that used to comprise the Keim farmstead. And the only other one that's missing from this grouping of slides is the structure that we have housing the cider press. I forgot. Yes, the cool cellar, the cave, which is just beyond the main structure. We still have that located at the Keim Homestead. But we should probably get back to Moore Latin Village.
Douglas
Mansion is an impressive building. It truly is. It's a great example of Georgian architecture with a touch of country vernacular, but it's just a great example of Georgian architecture. Not to the level of Potts Grove, which is just down the old Philadelphia Pike from us. Potts Grove, if you haven't been there, you really should visit. It's probably one of the best examples of Georgian architecture, colonial Georgian architecture, outside of colonial Philadelphia. It really is a great example. But what we have is the George Douglas House Mansion. This has undergone a huge amount of restoration work. And I have to say thank you to Larry Ward, who has really spearheaded most of our restoration work, and just a tremendously committed and dedicated volunteer to the trust. So the slide you see on the left is actually one of the rear corners of the Douglas Mansion. And if I could draw your attention to the top of the stone wall where the pent roof runs around that, it's what they call cove molding. And you may not be able to see it, but it's actually curved molding. And that is original to the house. Now, not all of that you see is original, but we did have some original, which gave us the template to complete the cove molding around the whole structure. So that's a great feature on that. Obviously, all of the window sashes have been refurbished, shutters have been redone. The room that you see on the right is what at one time had been the Douglas store. It's the, when you're facing the house from the front, it's the parlor or the room to the right of the main entrance. That's in the process of being completed. The windows have been everything has been redone. Slide to the left is the very impressive switchback staircase, which leads literally all the way to the third level of the house, with its, turn balustrades and chair rail and the paneling below the chair rail. Very impressive center hall. The slide to the right is actually a second floor, probably would have been a bedroom or bed chamber. It's interesting that the two second floor bed chambers both have corner closets or cupboards in them, and corner fireplaces. The four rooms to the left of the main entrance all have corner fireplaces. The room in the left slide is what we consider the main or good parlor. This is an amazing job. People have to understand that if you saw this room 5 years ago, first of all, the fireplace would not have been there, and most of the woodwork was not there. And the wall that you see to the right of the fireplace and the fireplace, the front and rear parlor were completely open. The fireplaces had been removed and the wall had been removed. So this was a complete rebuild, not just restoration work. This was a complete rebuild in that side of the house. We're not finished. We still have a lot of work to do, but we have made huge strides.
This will be open hopefully in the spring, correct?
Yes.
For an event?
And I apologize to all of our loyal followers. I know a lot of people look forward to the Christmas tea, which we have early in December. We have foregone that for the last 2 years simply because of the COVID situation. And then another tradition which has started is Twelfth Night. which would normally fall on the weekend closest to the 6th of January. We have, through, you know, with a sense of caution, we have decided to forego that for this year again. So please look forward to that. We're hoping that, by next year, we'll be able to do both of those major events. But to your point, yes, we're hoping that both the Douglas House and Mounds Jones will be to the point where we can have, a, for lack of a better term, a grand opening sometime in either spring or early summer. And even if the COVID numbers have not improved, at least it will be an outdoor event. And we will have the buildings open.
Excellent. All right. Well, I think we're unfortunately just out of time. So thanks again, Brad, for joining me. And thanks to all of our viewers for tuning in. And we will catch you next month. Thanks a lot. Good night.
Sights and Sounds of Historic Berks on BCTV is supported by the Berks Heritage Council.